understand me now. If sometimes you see that I'm mad, don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When everything goes wrong, you see.
Check, check.
This side okay?
That's perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Like this?
So you won't see each other again.
Okay.
Oh.
I see you in December. Thank you in advance.
So I'm going to go ahead and move all in. So
okay.
This front row right here.
All right. Okay. Church.
Which prayer book?
Hey, everybody.
Hi.
Welcome to Perry World House, the University of Pennsylvania's hub for global engagement. My name is Michael Horowitz. I'm a political science professor and the interim director here. And on behalf of Perry World House and the Andrea Mitchell Center, our co-sponsor for this event, thank you all for coming today. I'm not going to say anything about the event, though. I'm only here to introduce the most important person in the room, besides the authors and the moderator and all of you, but certainly more important than me, and that is the transformational leader that made Perry World House possible and that has been has helped the University of Pennsylvania grow and advance over the last decade. Our president, Amy Gutmann. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you so much. And thank you all for being here. It's wonderful to have you here. So in their new book, on page one of chapter one, our guests offer two very arresting observations. American civil society, they write, is among the most diverse and robust anywhere. So far, so good, right? However, they go on to say signs of democracy's decay are also everywhere. There it is in a nutshell. In one corner of the ring, We have the resilient promise of our experiment in democratic government. In the other corner, we have what happens when average citizens are forsaken, and as the authors so memorably put it, demagogues ride the rage to power, wrecking what has been painstakingly built. So how did we arrive at this impasse? More important still, how do we reclaim and how do we renovate what's been broken? So, with their new book, Renovating Democracy, Governing in the Age of Globalization and Digital Capitalism, Nicolas Berggruen and Nathan Gardels seek answers to these pressing questions and more. This is their second book together. Now, full disclosure, I am an ardent fan of Nicolas and Nathan and the forward-looking Berggruen Institute that they co-founded. The Institute has extraordinary scope, and it's dedicated to identifying transformational action to affect positive change in our society and around the world. I've also had the honor of sitting on the prize jury for the Berggruen Prize for Philosophy and Culture, which is the apex of recognition for world-changing philosophical and cultural thinking. So today, the tables are turned, and we have the privilege of hearing some profound thinking from the founders themselves. So let's meet them. First, we have the chairman of the Berggruen Institute and also of Berggruen Holdings. He has devoted his life's work to addressing the most fundamental philosophical and cultural questions of our changing and challenging times. He's also a master convener and connector, bringing people together to bring deep thought in the human sciences to bear on improving governance all around the world. Widely engaged in arts and culture, he sits on advisory councils for some of the world's premier institutions, from the Tate Museum to the Museum of Modern Art in New York. We're so pleased today to welcome Nicolas Berggruen. We're also pleased to welcome the co-founder and senior advisor to the Berggruen Institute. He is the editor-in-chief of the World Post, editor of New Perspectives Quarterly since its founding, and editor of Global Viewpoint and Nobel Laureates Plus since 1989. He's authored several books and he's published in everything from the New York Times to the Washington Post to an array of media outlets around the world. A member of the Council of Foreign Relations, his leadership in domestic and foreign policy has ranged from heading up influential think tanks to advising the administration of the governor of California. Let's have a very warm hand for Nathan Gardels. And our moderator today is one of Penn's own esteemed Perry Worldhouse visiting fellows. The foreign affairs columnist for the Philadelphia Inquirer, she recently received the Overseas Press Club of America's Flora Lewis Award for the best commentary on international affairs. She has twice been a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize in commentary, and she's author of the book Willful Blindness, The Bush Administration and Iraq. You know what her position, at least generally, is on that particular war. She's written from locations all around the world, and she's, I can testify because I've read so much of what she's written, a very astute commentator, ranging on commentary about China and Russia to Egypt and Kashmir. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our moderator, Trudy Rubin. Trudy. And so now we have democracy to renovate. So let's get started. Please welcome our wonderful guests.
Far left, far right, far right.
Okay.
Well, I can't think of a more opportune moment to be having this panel discussion. Needless to say, we're all looking at the TV and wondering what's going to happen next in Washington. So we have the example of the dangers of populism right before our eyes. And at the same time, China is celebrating its 70th anniversary in Beijing with parades and pomp and technology. And to add to Amy's excellent introduction to this book, the authors also have China hovering in the background of every chapter, because the issue really is the rise of populism in the West and China in the East, and whether, if democracy cannot renovate itself, the Chinese model is going to become the global lodestar. So what we're going to do is, I'm first going to turn to the two authors, and they will outline the structure of the book, which looks both at the problems facing liberal democracy today in terms of governmental institutions, in terms of a changing global economy where all the wealth is being created by technology in Silicon Valley, which benefits relatively few people and hires relatively few workers. And they're also going to take a look at nationalism. Is it possible to dial back hyper-globalism, hyper-nationalism, and create a positive nationalism? And at the end, we're going to look at the role of China and how that plays into what we must do and what happens if democracy cannot renovate itself. So let me start with Nathan, who's going to summarize for you what the basic thrust of the book covers.
Thank you, Trudy. Thank you, Amy, too. I guess you've left now, but especially thank you, Trudy. Trudy's one of the great journalists around these days on world affairs. She won the Flora Lewis Prize. Flora Lewis was once a legendary foreign affairs columnist for the New York Times for many years, and Trudy is a good following in her stead. So thank you, Trudy. As Trudy mentioned, what I like to do is just take 5 minutes and outline the skeletal frame of the book, because all the parts of it are related to each other. We can go into the details of what I suggest, what I talk about in the question and answer period. But the basic frame that we set is the rise of populism in the West, the rise of China in the East, and the spread of social media everywhere has prompted a rethinking of how democracy works, or how democratic systems work, or how they don't work. Globalization and digital capitalism have created new classes of winners and losers that the old social contract is not configured to deal with. Now, China comes into the picture because China challenges the dysfunctional democracies of the West to get beyond polarization and paralysis and reach a governing consensus by other than illiberal means, or risk falling into second-class status on the world stage. I'm not telling this group anything they don't know, that we have a so-called leader of the free world who relishes battling his way through every 24-hour news cycle by hurling barbed tweets at sundry foes. Meanwhile, the president of China has used his enormous power to chart out a roadmap for the next 30 years on everything from artificial intelligence to a new Silk Road trading route, and indeed to a new global order. So in the book, we have several responses to these challenges. The three Ps: participation without populism, predistribution of wealth instead of only redistribution, and positive nationalism. Participation without populism. Since social networks have drawn more players into the political fray than ever before, never has the need been greater for the impartial practices and institutions to sort out the cacophony of voices, the welter of conflicting interests, and the deluge of contested information. To mend the breach of distrust between the institutions of self-government and the public, we argue for a form of citizen engagement we call participation without populism, which means integrating social networks and more direct democracy into the system
through new mediating institutions that complement representative government. Probably the main response to the crisis we see today, not just in Washington, but in Britain and many parts of the world, is how to reestablish trust in the impartial institutions of governance. So that's what we focus on in participation without populism. We can get into this in the question and answer period, but that can mean everything from citizens' assemblies to a second reading by legislatures of citizen-initiated referendums. Just by way of one example, if such institutions of public deliberation had been in place before the Brexit referendum and all the consequences we now know had been aired, the outcome would have been likely quite different. Second point, predistribution. The innovations of digital capitalism are steadily disruptive and increasingly divorcing employment and income from productivity growth and wealth creation. So a social contract that responds to this dynamic must protect workers instead of jobs, for example, through universal benefits that are portable among workplaces, and foster an ownership share by all in the wealth being generated by the robots that are displacing gainful employment. The aim is to enhance the skills and assets of the less well-off in the first place, pre-distribution, instead of only redistributing the wealth of others after the fact. We call this universal basic capital. The idea is, instead of just tacking concentration from the top, we need to build wealth from below. In the digital age, the best way to fight inequality, the most effective way to fight inequality, is to spread the equity around. Last point, positive nationalism. In order to harness globalization, we call for dialing back, as Trudy mentioned, dialing back one-size-fits-all hyper-globalization to allow for post-industrial policies that build national economies, and embracing the allegiance to the values of an inclusive society instead of nationalistic incantation, but tempered by an understanding that open societies require defined borders if the social contract is to be binding. We can maybe talk about that more in the Q&A if you like. Positive nationalism is not the antithesis of global cooperation, it's the precondition for it. As Trudy mentioned also, we'll talk more at the end about China. We have a long section in the book about China based on our meetings over recent years with President Xi Jinping and others in the Chinese leadership. Our assessment is that conflict with China is as inexorable as cooperation is imperative. Conflict because of the race for technological dominance. Information technology, especially artificial intelligence, is not just another factor of production like machine tools. It lay at the very heart of the conflict between East and West. Control of data, information flows, free expression. Cooperation because of global warming. So what we call for in the book, and as an institute, we are engaged in doing this in practice, is what we call a partnership of rivals on climate action. If there is not some area of common intent around a convergent interest like global warming, all else will dwell in the shadow of distrust and will head into a new Cold War, which we're already headed into, to a world broken into geopolitical blocks once again, and worse. The US and China may well survive the decoupling of their economies from each other, but the world would not survive the decoupling of the climate face of these two largest carbon emitters on the planet. So just to recap, participation without populism, predistribution, positive nationalism. Our concern is that if we don't follow a path along this course, the West is positioning itself on the wrong side of history. So thank you.
Well, did you want to add anything, Nicolas, or I'll get right into questions?
Fire away.
You are making certain basic assumptions when it comes to the political piece of this, that centrist parties, center-right, center-left, are finished, is, I think, your basic assumption. And as the subhead of one of your sub-chapters says, entering post-partisanship party politics. So firstly, do you really believe that political parties as we have known them in the United States, for example, where we have a two-party system, are finished? And how do you see in integrating more public participation without running into the trouble that Britain did with the Brexit referendum and that California did way back when they had very destructive referenda that basically bankrupted the state?
Yeah, we have a section in the book, I think there's a question mark after it, post-party politics.
So, well, first then let me ask you, is it over?
Is it what?
Is it over? Is the party over?
No. Well, I think the part and parcel of the digital age and the fragmentation of the body politic and the fragmentation of the, let's call it the information ecosystem, is the old big tent parties of the industrial age that represented labor, capital, and had cohesive programs are finished. Because just as we move to just-in-time manufacturing and just-in-time delivery, we're moving to just-in-time politics, where I think you will increasingly see, as we have seen, the breakdown of the old parties and kind of the formation of political allegiance around separate issues or even personalities. So in Britain now, it's about Brexit. It's not about a big, it's Brexit or no Brexit. It's around that issue. It's not around all the issues of the welfare state and everything else. Same thing with Trump. The Republican Party essentially doesn't exist. It's Trump. The Democratic Party doesn't exist. It's 20 people with different ideas that are not cohesive. I would say that the, in Europe, it's even truer. The main parties in Germany are now pushed to the sidelines, and the alt-right and the Greens are now coming up into power. In Italy, it's even more so. The anti-establishment five-star movement, the only internet-based, it's not really a party, the only internet-based movement that come to power did so at the expense of the mainstream parties that have ruled for the post-war period. So how do we deal with this breakdown? Now, I want to add one point, though, where parties do still seem to work in the old way. The Big Ten parties is in China, where in some ways it's enforced, but also in Japan. So where there's a cultural underpinning, I think there's a possibility of parties in the old sense existing, but not so much in the West in the digital age. How does politics take place, and how you ask the question about referendums, the Brexit referendum or California? This is a key point. California, we didn't start this book or this thinking promoting direct democracy because we live in California and are active in California politics. Direct democracy is a condition. California, yes, we have a governor, yes, we have a legislature, but all the consequential decisions are made by the public at the ballot box on budget, on taxes, on the environment. Now the problem is, and this is the part of the impact of social media and the participatory power of social media, where people have information and think they can make decisions on their own without any mediation. So for example, in California, if you do a poll, you ask people, who should make the main decisions about budget and taxes? Should it be the legislators and the governor, or should it be the public? Overwhelmingly, in like 70 percentile, people say we should make the decisions. The next question is to the same polling group, what's the biggest area of spending? What's the biggest area of taxes? And the same people didn't know the answer. The answer happens to be K through 14 education is a big expenditure, and income tax is the biggest revenue in California. So the point is, people want to say, people want participation, but they don't have the information to do so. Now, all of us thought, I think, a few years ago, that the information revolution and the internet and social media was going to create more informed public than ever before. In fact, it's not the case that we see with Brexit. We have, or in all of our experiences. We have fake news, we have alternative facts, et cetera, et cetera. So one key element, if we're going down the path of direct democracy, the five-star movement in Italy, their slogan was participate, don't delegate. the referendum and Brexit, California's direct democracy. If we're going to go down that path in this age of the participatory power of social media, you have to find a mediating mechanism. You have to find a deliberative, a cool and deliberative filter that engages the public, but is able to have a space where there can be impartial, like I said in my opening, impartial practices and institutions to sort out the information, to sort out the contested interest, and deliberate and come to a consensus. Now, my final point on this is this it pie in the sky, or does this happen? In California, we can maybe talk later. We've gone partially down this path by creating a situation with law in 2014 where we have the legislature negotiating with the sponsors as kind of a second reading, sponsors of ballot initiatives, because they can fix unintended consequences or look at the budget implications that the public initiative is not looking at. In this way, we have had the first minimum wage law going up to $15 an hour, and we also had the first Digital Privacy Act. Both of those came out of initiatives from the public that the legislature negotiated with the sponsors and passed by legislation. But the most important example of this, how to reach consensus, how to create impartial institutions, was in Ireland. In 2 years ago, so that would be 2017, the Irish Parliament had a series of important issues that they wanted the public to decide, including abortion. I think Section 8 of the Constitution outlawed abortion. And so the question was, what does the public really think about this? How can such a polarized, emotional issue be discussed and come to some consensus? So they engaged a series of citizen assemblies, which are randomly selected citizens that represent gender and the characteristics of the society, brought together with experts. It's like a jury. You have the pro and con, the defense and the prosecution on a case. You have experts presenting facts, and people who are not vying for political power because they're not a party, looking at the facts in a more objective way and say, how can we make this work? So in the Irish case, after they had this discussion, there was a referendum on the abortion, and this body recommended that you take Section 8 out of the Constitution. It doesn't say you're for abortion or against abortion, it just shouldn't be in the Constitution. And that referendum passed by over 80%. So when you're outside the heat and passion and partisanship of elections, and you engage citizens in a environment where you can bring the facts to bear, you can come to a consensus and have a governing consensus for society.
So basically, what you are suggesting is that there has to be some way where there's citizens' input and there's some impartial provider of information to citizens which they can then pass judgment on. In the book, you talk about having a referendum and then having a standing body of experts who then feed back to the public, and then they vote on an intelligent version of the concept that they put forward. So the idea is somehow you have to get the citizens more involved, but you also have to get them more informed, and that there still has to be some political process to vote. Now, when you're talking about Ireland, that's a small country. The population was open to these citizen assemblies, and the party structure, which there is in Ireland, was not opposed. So what I'm wondering is, how do you envision a situation when you have deeply polarized political parties that are there, as they are in the United States? How do you get to a point, even if you are within a state and doing a state experiment, because so much comes from states in experimenting with politics, how do you get to the point where the partisan actors, the parties, let go, and where the public accepts expertise as they did in Ireland? Because expertise is becoming a dirty word in today's politics. So how do you get the partisans to let go? And how do you get the public in an age of social media conspiracy theories to accept expertise.
Yeah. Our experience in deliberative polling and these citizens' assemblies, as I said before, is when you take the, if we put it this way, if you take the parties out of politics, parties are vying for power. And so parties manipulate the debate, they fund social media campaigns. Their interest is in fragmenting the public and driving things to extremes in order to get into power and preserve the spoils that are associated with. Now, one way we've dealt with the partisan issue in California because of the initiative process is to end gerrymandering. Gerrymandering promoted, that is sitting legislature drawing the districts. So when legislatures draw their own voting districts, they're naturally going to try to draw them to promote themselves. And primaries have tended to have those vying for political power to play to the extremes, like Trump is playing now, or the Democrats in their own case, to position themselves. So in California, through the initiative process, we both ended gerrymandering by having a citizens commission draw the districts instead of the legislature, and we passed what we call a top two primary, where anybody wins. It could be two Democrats, it could be two Republicans, it could be two independents, or whatever. Whoever wins becomes the candidate. So it tends to diminish the extremes and push things toward the center. But on your question of how this works.
How would you get Trump's GOP, which is Trump, and a fractured Democratic Party to ever
I'll just party system. Well, I don't know how to answer that at the national level because all of us kind of throw up our hands on the national level. What I would say is the states, when governance is closer to the ground, citizens are more pragmatic. I keep repeating this because citizens aren't vying for political power. Citizens are trying to figure out what the problem is and how to fix it, and that's why they accept expertise. I'll give an example of California, but I want to go back to the states. So, in California right now, it's not the Trump versus the Democrats, but we've just had this battle over Uber and Lyft and the unions about whether contractors should be employees. So you have the unions on one side that say all independent contractors should be employees and have those benefits. Then you have Uber and Lyft on the other side, and all the people that use Uber and Lyft on the other side saying, we don't want that to happen. We want the flexibility. We want something between an employee and a contractor. The legislation was passed, it's called AB 5, or Assembly Bill 5, that favored the union side. Now there's initiatives to overturn, or it's called a referenda if you're trying to overturn a law, to overturn that law and take it to the public. In this case, we have a citizens' deliberative assembly that will look at all those facts. And I feel almost certain that what's going to come out of it is a compromise. It's going to be a new category between an independent contractor and an employee that preserves the flexibility, has a minimum wage, has, importantly, as I was saying before, has portable benefits across workplaces. You don't want to just work for Uber or Lyft, whatever. So I think the consensus is possible. But I just want to say one other thing about why we're thinking in these terms, and I'll stop. I know you're short question,
so much
long answer,
about,
but right. We kind of ground, I think one of the more interesting sections in the book is we ground this thinking in American history. We argue that this is we're at a period of a third turn of American democracy. The first turn, and all the innovations, institutional innovations, have come from the states first, and they percolate up to the federal level. So the Constitution that was signed here in 1789 was a result of 10 years of experience, or a little longer, in the American post-independent states, experimenting with their own constitutions. John Adams in North Carolina and whatever came up with the bicameral legislature, independent judges, so on and so forth. Okay, so I'm going to stop. But this is important because the conclusion they came to was that there needs to be public engagement, but there needs to be deliberation of decisions by the public. That's why The constitutional framers said, let's have a representative government, let's have independent courts, and so on. The next turn came 100 years later with the progressive movement. The progressive movement said, we need direct democracy because the political representatives have become corrupt, and if they're governing us and governing us badly, let the people decide. But they added to that smart government, which is essentially experts. Before that, there was no city managers, there was cronies that ran cities. So the second turn of American democracy was this progressive movement that was direct democracy and smart governance. The third turn we're arguing now, which is in a similar period of upheaval as technological upheaval as the progressive movement at the turn of the 20th century, is to marry again direct democracy with the deliberative concerns of the founding fathers. And I think that will come in the States first.
So if I were to summarize, I will offer that we're really talking here about the need for experiments at the state level, because at the national level, we're all throwing our hands up. And so perhaps it will only be with innovative state experiments if they are forthcoming. And California is sui generis, and it's now a one-party state. So I don't know that California can serve us all. It can be a petri dish. But we're hoping that there will be state-level or even metropolitan-level experiments that might somehow percolate up with formats for more citizen participation, if I understand you correctly. So let us move on to this question. Yes. So
maybe I agree. Maybe another way of saying it also.
Please.
And you started with that, is that the traditional editors or the traditional federators of citizens used to be political parties and traditional media. You know it very well. Those have lost power. And today you have movements in the US. You still have a two-party system because that's the structure, but in reality, the parties are no longer in control. And as Nathan talked about in Europe, the parties have lost power. So you need a new form. And the question is, what is that new form? And it's almost irresistible to engage citizens directly. That's what's beginning to happen at the state level. It's happening in certain countries, like in Italy. So it's going to be very hard to resist with social media and technology that enables everybody's voice. So we're at the beginning of that experiment, but we need a new editor. The question is, who is the new editor? And if the editor can be citizens themselves in a way that's organized and that is depoliticized, that's the point that Nathan was making before. If you're not, you know, congregating around political leaders or parties, you're going to be thinking for yourself or your fellow citizens. So it's a very different dynamic than a highly politicized dynamic. So the idea is, how do you lower the heat and still serve citizens, number one? And number two, how do you make sure that government is actually a service organization and a service organization for all, not just for those who have been elected?
You've raised a very important point that I want to ask you both about. When you're talking about citizens' movements, raising the issues themselves, and you use the example of the Five Star Movement in Italy. I think, as you both know, there are a lot of huge question marks about the Five Star Movement in Italy, because it's basically a website and a lot of individuals. And for many in Italy, the website is corrupted. It is run by individual, first the father, then the son, whom many Italian experts consider to be devious. And a lot of stuff that has gone over that website to its many individual members, because the party is not really a party, a lot of that stuff has been conspiracy theories, has been very dubious material, and has been straight out of the Russian playbook, copies of Russian websites. So there's so much to discuss, but since Five Star has been mentioned, I want to ask you, does the idea of citizens up, which seems extremely logical and necessary, but parties that are run in this manner and using Five Star as an example, does that throw up more dangers than solutions?
I think both. Any startup This is a startup. Any startup is not going to be perfect. There are going to be a lot of risks. Some are good and some are bad. Five Star so happens to have a long history in terms of intellectual history, but they're at the beginning of an experiment. It so happens that they're in power. So it's quite unusual, but it's the beginning of an experiment. And what we're witnessing in California has been around for a while, but it's become more and more powerful. So it's again, you know, something that's the beginning of an experiment. A place that experienced this kind of engagement for a long time, small place, is Switzerland, where you've had citizens' referendums for, you know, dozens of years, very sophisticated, and where, again, small place, you have democracy, you would say extreme democracy, but where everything has been depoliticized in terms of government itself. If you ask the Swiss, who is your president, most wouldn't know. There's a roving presidency in Switzerland, as opposed to the, you know, the system we have, let's say, in the US. So you have a lot of citizen engagement, you have citizens who are informed, citizens who are asked to participate all the time. So it's a practice. So I would argue we're at the beginning of that experiment, just the beginning.
All right. It seems that time has flown by faster than I expected. So I'm going to ask a question on the economic piece here, predistribution, that I will need a very quick answer to. And the idea of less evil forms of nationalism and the role of China and our competition with China, I fear is going to be but I'm telling you, will be left to your questions, and I might intervene in those questions. So I wonder if you could just summarize, because the issue is so interesting to me, your idea of trying to get Silicon Valley to share the wealth of the robots and how you would make them do it.
So if you think of, we're in an environment where inequality has increased, not just in the US, everywhere. And one of the reasons why inequality is increasing is that intellectual property, if you want the robots, are becoming more and more valuable. Capital and labor are becoming less and less valuable. So the question is, how do you redistribute so you tax more? That's the normal answer. The issue with that is that it's still a fight. And it doesn't, it just transfers from one side to another. It really doesn't enable. So our proposal is what we call predistribution, which is as opposed to taxing the robots, own the robots. So the idea is that when you start a company, let's say Trudy starts, Trudy's whatever, you know, software business, as opposed to owning 100% of that business, you may own 80% or 70% of that business. If you're successful, you're going to be happy. The business is going to be very happy. But the 20 or 30% that you don't own would be owned, in essence, by a fund for everyone, for all citizens. So everybody who's in this room, everybody who's working here, everybody who's not in this room would be a beneficiary of Trudy's success. So in essence, you share from the beginning as opposed to redistribute in a fight for taxes.
And you are assuming that the big tech companies in Silicon Valley would be willing to pay this tithe.
So you couldn't do it retroactively, no chance. But you could do it going forward, and you probably would have to do it in exchange of something. So we would have to say, all right, you, and California may look at experimenting with this. Again, California being a lab for a lot of these things, California might be willing to say, all right, 5% is owned by a state fund in exchange of 5 points less in taxes. So you, there's a trade-off. But at the end of the day, everybody benefits. The company, if it does well, no big change. The state benefits, very important. The state, you know, is no longer a debtor. And obviously citizens will benefit because the state fund is there for them.
Right, and I am going to take the moderator's prerogative because I've read the book and you mostly haven't. So I just want to throw out a couple of points that you might want to ask questions on because they're very interesting points that have been developed in the book. One of them is the idea of positive nationalism. And what the authors argue is that on the one hand, you can have a patriotic nationalism that is not negative, but in order for nationalism not to be dangerous, you have to accept borders and some kind of rational limitation on immigration. Otherwise, that whole issue is going to turn poisonous and wind up in poisoning your nationalist outlook, if I'm probably oversummarizing, but I throw that out because I think it's something you might want to touch on. And the other is on China, the authors, excuse me for taking this away from you, but I want to get it out there since we're going to questions. The other most important point is that if the US doesn't and Western liberal democracies don't reform, a centralized government like China is going to eat their lunch. And so what is to be done, and the authors have ideas.
Test, test.
Hi, my name is Vikram. I'm a first-year student in the college at Penn. My question is related to the concept of like positive nationalism. So if you accept that nationalism can be harnessed and you need to have X restrictions in order to keep nationalism constrained to the positive, at what point does it become a concession into which the definition of like positive nationalism gets constrained and constrained, so you need to cut this immigrants, then this immigrants, then this immigrants in order to keep nationalism in this little box?
I think I understand the question. We actually discuss this question in the book. You have some people like Gordon Brown, the former Prime Minister of Great Britain, who says don't talk about positive nationalism because you're conceding to the nationalist argument. You should talk about global cooperation is necessary. You can't deal with all issues like climate change, financial flows, if you go down that path of nationalism, no less the intolerance and the jingoism and so on. But the point we're making in the book is that we are polarized on this issue like every other one. Is there those who demonize immigrants and demonize asylum seekers, and there's those who demonize the people who defend belonging. In the book, we discuss Isaiah Berlin describing, the pluralist philosopher, describing what cultural pluralism has always meant before the end of the post-Cold War, the Cold War period, which is people defending their culture against empire, against Hollywood, against whatever. Now we're in a situation where cultural pluralism means tolerance for people who are incoming into a host society. The argument we just make in the book is that the social contract in any given society is binding only if people think it's fair and the burdens are shared fairly by everyone who's a participant. That means you have to have borders, Because states and, I mean, cultures and societies are not closed systems, but states are communities are fiscal jurisdictions with real fiscal realities and certain capacities. And if you end up having bad faith out of good intentions, if you can't fulfill the moral claims that you're presenting, which we're gonna accept everyone. So you're inviting a backlash if you don't consider the social contract in nationalism. So we're saying there needs to be a balance there. You don't wanna demonize either side. Canada's a good example. Canada accepted 25,000 refugees from the Syrian war for asylum, but Canada has a very strict merit-based immigration system, not too different from what Trump is proposing, based on labor skills and assets of people when they come. So in Canada, 60% of immigration comes under the economic category, meaning you have skills and assets, and only 20% comes from family relations. The United States is just the opposite. 60% comes from people because families are already here, and only about 20% comes from their economic or skill base that meets the labor market. So you have to have a balance. Otherwise, you're inviting nationalism. In this corner over. There's two people up there. Oh, women.
This is based on the question Vikram had. Hi, sorry. My name is Juliana. I'm a graduate student in social policy and data analysis. What adjustments do you think are necessary to maintain the social contract but still allow for the migration patterns that are inevitably going to arise within the next 30 years with climate patterns possibly putting entire island nations underwater?
That's a big question. I would just say that the social contract I was talking about, we would talk about when my opening remarks, and if we're talking about pre-distribution, you have to have a set of citizenry that's gonna benefit from that. And it can't leak too much or it's not gonna work. You're not gonna think it's fair. Or whoever's benefiting or not benefiting is not gonna think it's fair. I think there is a problem, to answer your question with a question. I mean, I think the problem is we're in a dilemma where asylum and refugees and immigrants have become a fused category. The idea of immigrants and refugees used to be if they're fleeing war and conflict in their own territory, Trudy has written about this a lot, they should get asylum. If you're fleeing El Salvador, not because the government is prosecuting you, but the government's too weak to protect you, does that make you a refugee? If your husband is beating you, does that mean you should be able to get into the United States? I don't know all the answers to that, but the question arises because of what you say. There are more human flows than ever before in history because of logistics, communications, growing population. But somehow we have to make a distinction between refugees and immigrants. I think the immigrant side has to lean toward what I said before. It has to lean to balancing the social contract in a host country. The asylum issue, I think there needs to be a lot of thinking about how to define what asylum is and what a refugee is, and I don't think we're clear on that.
Hi, my name's Lewis. I'm a junior at Penn. And so you were talking about how Western liberal democracies need to reform. And I was wondering, like, the converse can be said about China. So where are the, like, reforms kind of coming from in Chinese society? Is there something about their culture or, like, a mechanism within their government that makes that a Chinese government easier to reform? And do we see a similar thing in the U.S.?
I'm happy to take it, but I have to understand it better.
Yes, exactly.
What can we learn from China? Is that the question?
Basically.
Yes.
Well, China, different history, different culture, different political system. And at least in our minds, will continue to be very different. And we have to, in the West, accept that China comes from a totally different place. I think that's one of the issues that we will have to, in the West in general, deal with and accept. China is not going to become like us, and we don't want to become like China. But the question is, can we learn something? Maybe what we can learn is that, not by choice, but as part of the culture, and certainly as part of the political system, China is able to bring the country together. And the question is, can we bring, you know, the different voices that we have and we want to maintain together to build a long-term future? In the past, we didn't have any competition in the West, no real competition. In theory, we had the Soviet Union. It failed. Now we have real competition. We have China. And China, with a very different culture, a very different system, is able to make long-term decisions, long-term investments. If they want to deal with climate, they can. Can we deal with climate? The only way we can deal with climate is if we decide to work together within a country and between countries to deal with it. So the question is, how can we, in some cases, take long-term decisions and, you know, follow a long-term view as opposed to short-term politics, which really, we can see, hampers our ability to potentially prosper, but also creates enormous amount of anxiety within society.
I just want to follow up on that. You say in the book, and I think you said earlier, that if China and the United States cannot form a partnership on some issues, and you particularly say on fighting climate change, then you have a very dark prognosis for the world at large. Looking at it from the Chinese side, and both of you have spent a lot of time there talking to senior officials, do you think Xi Jinping is really willing to cooperate? I don't ask you to go into Donald Trump, but just from the Chinese side.
On climate?
Seriously cooperate.
I think two things.
Yeah.
And maybe Nathan will answer the climate issue specifically, but I think two things. Number one, I think we have no choice but to cooperate. And you know, if you have a totally different culture and different political system, but you're both very strong, which is now the case, and you want to coexist in the world, you have to find a way to cooperate because there are too many issues that can put you in conflict, and a conflict would be, you know, fatal between those two cultures. But two, because you have to address issues that are global issues, like climate, but it's also health, it's security, it's a number of different things that, you know, it binds us all as humans on Earth. Obviously, climate is the most extreme one. So one, it's a necessity. Two, certain things you can't deal with unless you cooperate globally.
I would say one area where China will not cooperate is technological dominance. The entire project of Xi Jinping and Chinese rejuvenation comes from China's humiliation under colonialism in the 19th century, because they fell behind the West in technological advance. China will trade soybeans, China will do all kinds of stuff. China will not give up its race to dominate AI or any of the advanced technologies, because that's the whole basis of rejuvenating China. So I think there, as I said before, that conflict is inexorable.
So we're going to take two final questions before we wrap up, and we'll have time with our guests at a reception with the invited members to now. We'll take one question from the floor here, we'll take the final question from the stairs, we'll take them together.
You have a lot of power picking.
Not nearly enough. There is a woman who behind you, and then there's a woman who's raising her hand. These two, please, yes, you two.
Hi, my name is Amy Guillot. I'm a grad student in the School of Education. Coming from a school of education, it seems like there might be a very important role for whether it's public K-12 educational institutions or universities like Penn in this positive nationalism or participation without populism. So I'd just be curious to hear what role do you see for educational systems?
Hers was
that
duplicate.
Was my question. So we'll take your question,
put
them together.
Hi, I'm Brendan. I just graduated, actually. I was wondering, when you talk about defending workers and not jobs, do you mean to focus on welfare in the sense of like a right to work? So in terms of training people to participate in a more service-based economy? Or are you thinking more in terms of sort of instituting like a universal basic income? In other words, do you think that the future of the labor market is one in which people everyone should be able to participate in the labor market, or will people be pushed out by automation?
So I'll answer that one maybe, and then you answer the education. So what we're proposing is the equivalent of universal basic capital as opposed to universal basic income. So at the end of the day, every citizen has a piece of a large pool of capital, which is for everyone. It can draw on that capital in their life span. So at the very beginning, when you're a baby, you get healthcare, then you get education, then you can draw on it to, buy a place to live. And depending on how your career goes, from time to time, supplement it in terms of income. But the idea is that there's flexibility depending on where you are in the stage of your life. So that's really the idea. Education is key. And so part of what we propose here is that you have the equivalent of capabilities from the beginning, meaning that it allows you as a person to participate in society, in the economy. And what do you need? You need education, you need access to healthcare, you need a roof, you need a number of different things, but education is obviously one of the key ones. And
the idea of protecting workers instead of jobs is that because of the tumult of steady disruption of digital capitalism, people's benefits should not be linked to the workplace. They should be universal benefits that are shared among workplace, like pensions should be portable. And also, training, like in Scandinavian countries, they call it flex security. Training and benefits that are portable. That's really key to protecting workers instead of focusing on jobs. On education, the other element of predistribution that has two pillars. One is this universal basic capital idea we've been discussing. The other one is public higher education. The surest route to upward mobility is public higher education. I'll take one example. The top university in the country for upward mobility is Cal State Los Angeles, where the bottom 20% move to the top 20% of income after graduation. It's the top school in the country that does it as a public school, a public university, part of a system of 23 campuses. It's really the transmission belt to the middle class. The problem that you have today is inequality, with all due respect to University of Pennsylvania, I shouldn't say it, to Stanford, let's say, or Harvard, is the inequality of endowments of the public university system, which has suffered cuts all around the country, not just California, and the private system. Stanford University, for example, has 42,000, the endowment per student for Stanford is 42,000. The endowment per student for Cal State Fullerton, the largest of the Cal State campuses, is $4,000. So the gap between the Ivy League type schools and the public education is one of the perpetuators of plutocracy and inequality. And so that's the other element of predistribution, is the skills and assets that need to be enhanced.
I'm Sarim. I'm a freshman at Penn, and I guess my question is framed around a world in which, like, developing countries are sort of disillusioned with the neoliberal world order and have turned to China's Belt and Road Initiative, but there's flaws, like, which are coming up in that as well. In light of that, what course of action do you think the United States should implement, in the sense that should it withdraw from the developing world, or should it implement a new package of reforms which it could advertise to these developing countries?
I'm not sure. I didn't get that from the recently. Yeah, to talk about aligning a partnership of rivals or aligning around convergent interests, I think one obvious thing, and we mentioned in the book, is that Europe is, go back to immigration issue, Europe is suffering this whole immigration issue mainly because of Africa. China is hugely engaged in Africa in terms of investment, but hard investment, infrastructure investment. Europe should be engaged in what's called soft infrastructure, education, healthcare, and so on. That kind of partnership would make a huge difference both to Africa and to immigration issues. So I think the West should engage, obviously, with China and complement its, you know, China's a lot of walk around capital that the West doesn't have. And I think those things are complementary. I will just say one other thing, though, that's interfering in this going forward, is as China develops artificial intelligence, it has a huge database because everyone's on a smartphone, and AI learns very quickly in China, and same way in the United States. Those two countries are racing away from the rest of the world in terms of artificial intelligence and the advanced technologies. And I think that's going to create a greater gap. So this kind of cooperation is going to be more important, but it's going to be more difficult.
Trudy, great.
Okay.
Thank you. Well, you've done great with the cold.
You're very professional. You just move it through like a.
It's impressive. Well run. Everything here is well run.
Very nice to see you. Do you come to the library?
Okay. Thank you so much.
It absolutely is. Wonderful. It's wonderful.
What's that?
Very nice to meet you.
Sure. Do we take off?
I have to find out who has my backpack.
Can we take it off?
Thank you for coming. I'm going to get you into a photo, and then you'll be able to. Okay. And do you know where my backpack is?
Yes. Yeah.
It's very nice to see you. Thank you very much.
So Christian has it. He has it in his office.
Okay. Great.
Started.
I know, that's the
you
problem.
You were great. You were great.
You know, I misguessed the time.
It seemed to go so quick.
Yeah,
it was. The discussion was very rich. There was so much.
It was faster than I somehow.
All right.
It was my pleasure. Nice, I wish
you.
I had more time to talk with both of you.
Thank you.
I can't wait to see you again.
Yeah,
as
all right.
Always.
We'll see
so
each other.
Yeah.
So you wanted to give her a cold, but not us.
Well,
that shows a certain
that shows
relationship.
Love. Though. Love.
Yeah,
she won't
yeah.
mind.
Okay. Women are more impervious or something.
Yes, that's right. Our immune systems are built up.
That's it.
Thank you again.
Bye-bye.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah, no, the time, I thought we had more time, actually.
Yeah, I thought, yeah.
But anyway, Malesh,
did
as they say.
Did I answer your question finally? I'm not sure.
Yeah,
Annie. Because that's the hardest question to answer. How do you get the Trump Republicans?
Yeah, if you had the answer to that, you should be running. But anyway, great pleasure to meet
you.
Are you guys running off? Are you coming in here? Or,
you want to talk about China now?
Okay.
Okay. Nicolas, go greet the.
No. I don't. I'm with you here.
We can go talk. Sit down here and talk.
So
first, I want your phone number.
My, let me give you
your
my
card.
Give a pen.
Yeah.
What I always say about China, you know, we have the quote in there, Lee Kuan Yew, China will not be a democracy and will not be an honorary member of the West. What I always say is, it's implicit in the book, but the shorthand I would say, is China is both, it's repressive that everybody knows, but it's also responsive. That's what's kept it in power. And there's even, I quote John Keane, this Australian guy, saying, the Chinese Communist Party is so fearful of democracy that they actually act like elected officials in responding to the public to maintain their legitimacy. The problem now with Xi Jinping is whether there's a balance between responsiveness and repression. If repression overcomes the responsiveness, it's not going to work.
Well, you talk about that. I mean, I'm going to Hong Kong and Taiwan, too.
Oh, that's great.
Look, you've been going to China forever. I'm going at a lower level than you are, but I used to talk to NGOs that are no longer allowed to function, and I would talk to senior officials who would say, we need those NGOs because otherwise we don't know what's going on in the countryside because we can't trust the officials.
Right.
They're stamping that out. They've stamped out the free media, Southern Weekend, Kaizen, et cetera.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, the question to me, have a seat, sir.
And my phone.
All right.
And Gardels at earthlink.com.
Earthlink. All right.
I had my email 10 years ago. It's the same email. That's why I keep it.
All right. Well, here's a real one. Can you write yours, too? Oops. Excuse me.
Smart students, by the way. Good question.
Oh, yeah. No, they are smart. Very privileged, but smart.
Yeah.
What you said about the competition, the tech competition, obviously Xi Jinping has put it right out front and center. So how do you prevent that kind of competition from turning into, and here's a plain one, how do you turn, I mean, if you declare that you're out to beat somebody, you're in a race to the death.
Well, I think that's where they are. I think the have this guy, Kai-Fu Lee.
I've read his book.
And Kai-Fu, you know,
and he says, we're going to win.
And Eric Schmidt is coming out with an article in National Interest soon, saying what happens if China wins the AI race. The very dark article. But like I said, I think the Trump administration, either they understand this or they don't understand it. I'm not sure which, Navarro. Well, they understand what the consequences if China wins the tech race. But they don't understand the impulse, like I was saying, behind the whole Xi Jinping project, which is never again to fall behind the West. And so to take these across-the-board actions against Huawei, for example, you know, and say no one can buy their technology, that just makes the Chinese 100% convinced that the only route to go is to pull all the resources in. And I think the U.S. is making the competition more perfect. I mean, it's accelerating their competition. You had the parade yesterday with all the military stuff.
Right.
Why is China self-sufficient in all of its military technology? Because after Tiananmen, we boycott. No one can sell anything in the West to Chinese technology. Now they have their own.
Right.
They're not like they're not like Burkina Faso, you know, China. So they're going to grade the AI.
So you think the ban? I mean, that they're going to